following program is classified G. It's suitable for all ages. We would like to remind our viewers that the views expressed in this program by our participating guests are solely viewpoints of them who take part and does not reflect the views and beliefs of the Verana Media Network.
Welcome to Gen XYZ. This week, as we just passed World Youth Day, we decided to take something that is pertinent with that and bring in an individual who is leading the cause of the youth within this country and really take his take on how the country is going forward. We have with us Damitha Vikramasinghe, the National Youth Services Council Chairperson. He's also the Director General for Youth Services within Sri Lanka. Thank you so much for joining us in this busy time schedule. You also are the former chairperson for the Sri Lanka Vocational Training Authority when you joined us last time. So as our viewers would understand, the topic today will be ranging around exactly the situation of the youth as of now and our process forward, because apart from any other sector, the youth are very much engulfed in understanding what their future will look like, and that is where your responsibilities also come in. Firstly, as the chairperson of the National Youth Services Council, a lot of responsibility. How are you coping with the pandemic situation as of now?
Well, Danidu, the pandemic is global and the pandemic is somewhat here to stay with us. I think I mentioned that even at my previous program with you when I was the VTA chairman. So basically we have to work around it. You can't be complaining saying COVID this, COVID that, right? So you have to always innovate. Now, I always say that COVID was a blessing in disguise. You know, especially the human race, the transformation into digitalization, it got rapidly advanced. I mean, from grandparents onwards, everybody had to go digital because they couldn't survive otherwise. So likewise, now if you take, if I am to tell you about the experience at Youth Services Council, especially we have a larger mandate. I mean, the mandate is very diverse, very broad in terms of youth development. For instance, now from aesthetics to farming to vocational training to entrepreneurship. So that is the whole spectrum. So basically, Youth Services Council itself is a small state within the state, right? So addressing 1/4 of the population. So we have taken very progressive steps, especially our vocational training, almost 90% is ongoing in the online mode. And also now, for instance, if you take farming, all those trainees, we have put them into a bio bubble. So they cannot move out from the farm. They are free to, you know, leisurely do whatever within that premises. So likewise, I mean, you can't always complain. I mean, now, for instance, people are complaining to the government to shut the country. You know, shut the country. Once the country is shut, what we don't understand is, right, only 25% of this population has a guaranteed monthly salary income, right? Even at that, the private sector, you cannot afford to go on paying 100% without any substantial, you know, economic value creation. Yeah. So people have to understand and people have to innovate. And basically now, classic example, touchwood, up to now, COVID is almost here for 2 years. And within those 2 years, I have been roaming around the country for various work. But up to now, because I take my precautions, I have always have my sanitizer in my pocket. Mm-hmm. I keep my mask as a divine, you know, equipment. Mm-hmm. And I have managed to, you know,
stay away from
COVID.
Yeah.
I don't know about tomorrow, but up to now, I mean, it's the responsibility of the citizen. Likewise, that is the message we give out to the youth also. Don't complain, try to innovate. This is a new situation. So if you can overcome that, you are the winner.
Very well put, I should say, when it comes to our first segment. Now, the first things I want to clarify, you really gave a good context to where I want to go, entrepreneurship, you know, aesthetics. The youth are diverse, they have different interests, and all of these areas were affected, and all of these areas have different targets, as in these individuals have different targets on their mind. My next question is, Now, the youth had challenges in the past. Now, when it comes closer to an election, we again bring up this discussion of whether youth should take part in politics, and that comes up again. You also, since you have been part of the youth, we are working with the youth. Should that sort of empowerment stage happen today, happen now? And can it happen now? Because my issue is the challenges have changed from maybe a few years ago to today. Now, with the pandemic, the challenges the youth are facing have changed a bit. How have you identified these challenges?
Well, it had the pandemic has made our job easier, I would say. Now, also, I must mention our able leadership, the Honorable Minister of Youth and Sports, Namal Rajapaksha. For the first time in this country, we have a young personality who's leading the youth ministry and a sportsman running the sports ministry. So that itself is a blessing for this country, and he looks at the challenges very progressively. Now, why I say the job got easier? Because now there is no choice, no, right? You cannot complain. You will have to do, otherwise you will not exist.
Exactly.
Now, I think in that sense, the youth of this country have taken it up very well, I would say. Now, for instance, now we launched last month, 15th, was the World Youth Skills Day. So, based on that, we launched an entrepreneurship scheme. And within that entrepreneurship scheme, we have a sort of, you know, subclass, which is very interesting. Now, we are giving out entrepreneurial assistance to gamers,
okay,
right, which has become a global, you
industry
know,
now.
Sort of a top end kind of a
it's an industry, yes, at this point.
Not even industry, a profession, I would say, right? And the funniest thing is, now I met the minister has met a guy from Anamadua, a young chap who earns $6,000 a month by gaming, a farmer's son.
Foreign revenue,
exactly. And for that, now we are targeting to, you know, give out loans for all this gaming equipment and IT laptops or whatnot, and, you know, create entrepreneurs in the digital sphere, right? Now, conventionally, we think, you know, you have to make him an industrialist, or you have to make him producing something that is visible physically. But now, see, you are better off playing games, right? So now I don't complain, my son playing games also. So
because there's an entire,
exactly,
entire occupation attached.
Yeah.
My next question now, since you have an entire background in entrepreneurship, and we have really spoken about this before as well, let's give some time for it and really understand what the youth can do today to instill this entrepreneurship culture. I think it's very good that, you know, the chairperson of the NYC understands now that there is different avenues that the youth have gone into. What else can we do as a primary step, as a step that within this pandemic, as the youth looks at maybe the next year or then the following year for the International Youth Day, how does that empowerment work in terms of creating entrepreneurship? Because today we are in a unique point, and everyone understands that this is a very unique character, unique feature that we have, unique time in the history, something that we haven't seen before. How can the entrepreneurship aspect be empowered further?
Well, first of all, we should start from the elderly generation, parents, teachers, other, you know, stakeholders who, you know, interact on a day-to-day basis with the youth of this country, because for the simple fact being, we don't still have an entrepreneurship culture, right? If you ask any parent whether they want to, you know, convert their children into entrepreneurs, majority will say no. Why? Because we are at the mentality is such, we are looking at a, you know, stable job, that also being a government job, right, if possible. But ultimately what happens is the productivity of that person gets completely destroyed. See, I came to the public sector from the private sector. You know, my pay cut alone is 90%, right? So that sacrifice we are willing to do for the country, because we have a great faith in HE President and also the Honorable Minister, who is a very close friend of mine. So I'm always willing to, you know, go the extra mile for him. But why I told you this was, now if you join the public service, maybe at a very low, you know, sort of labor position, what in life can you achieve, right? But without doing that, if you get yourself absorbed in somewhat of a entrepreneurship scheme, for instance, you can, you know, grow something. Mm-hmm. You can turn into a dairy farmer. Now, classic example. Last month, while I was going on an official visit in Kandy, I happened to go to a micro cattle farm, which I think 30 perch land maximum, I would say. He has 15 cattle, right? 15 cows, 3-4 reproduction, and the other produces milk. Okay. And it's like in a scientific, very tied up cattle shed, very nicely done. And one person, only himself, is working there. And can you imagine what he's earning? 300,000 minimum a month. And the funniest and the most, you know, enticing fact is, he has, like, in a normal day, working hours about 2-3 hours. Most of the time, he spends his time leisurely doing that, but you have to do it. When you do it, you have to do it properly. Likewise, if we think in that entrepreneurship culture, if you believe in that, and there is always the government organizations, including NYSC, to help them out, but it has to come from society. Mm-hmm. And I think parents and teachers have to play a major role in this.
All right, very good start there. My next question is going to be something you touched on. The people generally ask the government, ask organizations such as the NYSC, what is this organization doing for the youth to be empowered? Mm-hmm. I want to ask you that question as well. Let's go in for a short break. Stay with us on GenXYZ. GenXYZ, we are in conversation with Amitha Vikramsinghe, the chairperson of the National Youth Services Council. My next question, as we spoke about before we went in for the break, is about this entrepreneurship culture. Now, you spent a lot of time in a partly educational atmosphere also when you were the chairperson for the Vocational Training Authority, and you know there were questions there. There was a challenging position for you. The youth, the public would ask, what exactly is the government doing in this status quo today to support this entrepreneurship culture?
What is the government not doing? That is my question. Now, see, for instance, I mean, people of this country, I mean, it's sad in a way, Danidu, they don't know how to, you know, reap the benefits of the existing system. Now, for entrepreneurship, if we take from some of the authority, up to the large government-owned commercial banks, they have specialized schemes. There is an information gap for sure, that I believe 100%. Now, for instance, it should be the other way around also. The youth of the country or the general masses should ask what we can do for the country, right? Now, if you take protests, they have all sort of questions, but can any of them give the answer? Right? Why don't you protest with the answer? Right? We have such an issue. So this is the answer that we believe in. Can you do it? No. They always keep complaining, which itself is wrong. But I think the youth of the country now have realized, and they have their thinking is a little different from the previous generation. Now, in terms of what the government does, I can tell you about the NYSC experience. Now, we, as I told you before, we have launched an entrepreneurship scheme called Hope for Sri Lanka. So within that entrepreneurship scheme, up to 2 million, we are giving out loans specially. Now this difference is, now we have created the big business ecosystem. Mm-hmm. If you take greenhouses, the entrepreneur has to only run it. Mm-hmm. We have taken care of the buyback and everything. So the success rate will be higher. Now, for instance, if you grow Kochi in that greenhouse, that is the plan we are going to initiate in the Kalam district, especially, you can earn about 150,000 a month. with all, you know, expenses deducted, the net income will be about 150,000. Mm-hmm. Now, if you run a tri show all 30 days, right, 10 hours a day minimum, you cannot even earn half of that.
Yeah.
And you are doing something productive as well for the economy, mm-hmm. productive something for yourself. You are also, you know, basically doing something productive as well as tangible results, mm-hmm. right? So likewise, the cattle industry, the IT experience I told you about, and these greenhouses, we have thought about the entire ecosystem from production up to the consumer. NYC is involved, mm-hmm. in whatever possible capacity, as well as, you know, especially creating the value chain. Mm-hmm. Now, for instance, the buy-bike agreement goes from NISCO Cooperative Society, which is a cooperative society functioning under NYSC. Mm-hmm. So the job of the entrepreneur is somewhat eased. Mm-hmm. And also gradually, we can't expect them to be, you know, Bill Gates within, you know, 6 months. No, mm-hmm. So we have to gradually groom them. So we have minimum 2 years commitment with them, mm-hmm. to ensure that they come up.
All right. Since you did touch on the NYSC, and, you know, now I spoke about the expectations from, and very well addressed, I should say, something that I want to touch on now, this role of the NYSC, something that we keep coming back to, because is it something arbitrary? Because this discussion comes up generally when you're closer to an election, when you're closer to something of that sort, this youth empowerment topic comes up, but that youth empowerment doesn't happen throughout the previous time frame. What have you identified as the core role of the NYSC as of today?
As I told you in the beginning, the NYSC, or the National Youth Services Council, being the apex body, according to the Act of Incorporation, the NYSC has such autonomy, mm-hmm. vested within itself. It's like a small state within the state. And it takes care of education, as I told you, agriculture, entrepreneurship, finances, cooperative. NISCO has a banking license under it, which had been destructed, especially during the last 6 years. So we are again rebuilding that. So the role of NYSC is to ensure that the entire youth population is guided, enriched, and given opportunities to come up in life as well as to become a productive citizen. So therefore, from aesthetics to, you know, economics, I would say, we cover. But unfortunately, although it has a powerful act and a powerful vision in the incorporation, none of the administrations have identified the real potential of the institution. Now, luckily, as I told you, Minister Namal Rajapaksha has a great vision and great thinking, and he is very futuristic and very up to date on how the world runs. Mm-hmm. So basically, previously NYSC has been an organization full of events. May it be Yon Puriya, may it be Yavuna Krida, may it be Yavuna Sammana, whatnot, right? Where, you know, you gather youth, get them engaged in something, and, you know, send them home without, you know, grasping anything, mm-hmm. right? Now, our approach is different. We are more focused on entrepreneurship. We are more focused on employment, you know, creation. Especially now, we launched another program called Youth to World. Now we are going to place them in foreign jobs, where they will be earning in foreign currency and bring it back to the betterment of the country. Likewise, our approach is, now, classic example, if you join a youth club at the age of 13, once you go out from the system at 29, if you have not gained anything apart from going for a few events, you will not send your son to that. You will not send your daughter to that, mm-hmm. right? So likewise, now the Youth Cup Federation identification card, now we have digitized. We are going to launch it very soon using blockchain technology. So all of that has thought through, and our approach is very different from the past approaches taken by the several administrations.
Since you touched on the topic of youth club, I wanted to bring it up later on in the discussion, but let's talk a bit about it now, because I should say, when it comes to the more western side of the country, they're not pretty much aware of how the youth clubs function, but it has become more of a regional thing where that engagement isn't available. Has that engagement improved? How has that reception been to a youth club as of today?
Well, engagement has improved somewhat, because when we took over, the membership was standing at around 250,000. Now we have taken it up to 400,000 within these 4 months. And there is somewhat of a disparity also, Danidu, because now the urban youth community doesn't have that feel-good factor to join, right? I mean, especially the urban youth are in their mentality also different. So like I told you before, if you don't reap any benefits, if you want to, you know, participate in some events, you have so many institutions. You can join Leo, you can join Interact, you can join guiding, right? Likewise, there are so many other things that you can do. Yeah. So to take it to, you know, especially the urban and metro regions, the approach would be, you know, you have to build your brand first. To build the brand, you have to have several activities which are attractive. Right, you can get a person from a city to join the entrepreneurship scheme, but they will not come and, you know, run in your local marathon, right? So every segment has to have a, you know, sort of a USP, I would say, unique selling point to attract them. So now we are working on it. I think we have somewhat succeeded. Also, now under the Youth Services Council, NYSC had the country license for Duke of Edinburgh Youth Award, which is an award based in England, yeah, I would say UK, initiated by the late Duke of Edinburgh. And unfortunately, what has happened is that license was also, you know, taken out. Now I have again, you know, applied, and thankfully we have been given the license. That is the approach we are going to take for English speaking schools, urban schools. You have to have several products to attract several segments of your customers. So that's the approach, I would say.
All right. A few other segments that I want to touch on. We'll take a very short break and really break down the new initiatives that the NYSC has undertaken, which is a bit something, as you said, has not been coordinated or communicated in a mass amount. Let's talk a bit about that. Let's take a short commercial break. Stay with us on Gen XYZ. Gen XYZ. We are in conversation with Damita Vikramasinghe, the chairperson of the National Youth Services Council. My next sort of approach I need to take is education. Now, we touched on it quite a bit. Education, industry sector that has been hit hard by the pandemic. People were confused in the initial stages, but now the youth, especially the youth, have taken up certain roles. How do you, as the chairperson of the NYSC, witness this? Have you seen new methods that people are educating themselves upon? Is it still, you know, school, get a degree, find a job kind of mindset that is going on? But you did mention about entrepreneurship. Are there any other ways where this education is being grasped or given out from the state?
Well, first of all, if you mention about the impact of COVID, I think the hardest hit and the most unfortunate situation is for school children. Although you give them education online, the social experience that you go through at that certain age, you cannot get it back. No. There is no other way. University students or any tertiary education students, they have gone through that. So I feel really bad, especially one of my cousin's sons. From grade 9, he is now sitting for O-levels without going to school a single day, right? So which is very unfortunate. But then again, I mean, you can't help it, no? So there is no other way than innovating yourself. Also, I think the pandemic gave a good opportunity for Sri Lankan education institutes to do a proper identification of the segmentation that is needed. Mm-hmm. Now, especially in the vocational industry, if you take where I was before, and also don't forget NYSC also has a large vocational institute under it. Mm-hmm. We also cater to about 25,000 vocational students per annum. We could do a rationalization of what to do and what not to do. A majority of the vocational courses, even at NYSC, are outdated and not of any use for the modern world. So our plan is now, especially now, if you take area like IT, even IT, the elementary level IT is just basic life skill. Right, there is no point of teaching somebody that and giving a certificate which is not valued at all. Right, so now we have, little by little, we are converting. Now we have started a Cisco lab and a Cisco program which we are going to take national, as well as we are looking at training technicians for new industries. Especially now pharmaceutical industry will have a major boom because current government has established three industrial parks for pharmaceutical manufacturing. Mm-hmm. So once these investors come, you have to have trained technicians to work and make the factory functional. Sure. So in that, we have started discussions with the Pharmaceutical Manufacturers Association, and we are looking at their numbers, mm-hmm. what to produce, because we don't want to overproduce.
Sure.
Once you teach somebody to manufacture pharmaceuticals, there is no guaranteed job. But even then, you have enough opportunity overseas.
True.
Even a Chinese company came there, wanted to invest in the pharma industry. They are even ready to take trained technicians to China. Right? Mm. Now, China is also apparently facing a major, technician shortage. Right, so there are many opportunities, and this is the best time to revisit your operation rather than sitting on it and saying COVID and all that. Because Anidu, I tell you, each and every day during this pandemic, I have been going to work. Right, now I don't want to. I mean, I'm not encouraging people to leave home and expose yourself, but top management, that's the responsibility. No, you can't say pandemic can sit at home and do nothing. Mm-hmm. So we have come to a very productive manner during the COVID situation up to now, and this revamping or the new sectors of education, mm-hmm. will be launched by January next year.
Mm-hmm. My next question is going to be on now this. The thought process is actually very sustainable, very productive, as you mentioned, because we are looking at what the job market requires and then creating people to join in that sector. Again, I come back to this issue of reception. How has it been when it comes to people coming in and joining, or the youth particularly, in this current status quo, joining hands with the IT, the NYC or the government or other state bodies when it comes to taking a step forward in that direction? Because is that where the lacuna exists? Because if we have that participation, if we have that motivation to come in and join and support, take this baton forward, I believe a lot of these issues would be ironed out.
Yeah.
So are you addressing that, or have you been able to address that before?
Yeah, especially I would say we are addressing that because we are doing extensive PR campaign, especially in the digital sphere now, although we are sitting in a TV channel. Mm-hmm. Now, my thinking of communication is that it has gone digital already. Mm-hmm. I think even for a free-to-air channel to exist, you have to have a digital handle, right? So we are very active in that. And also, I must say, the communication gap is definitely there. Like I said, this country has the amount of agencies the government has created, mm-hmm. to serve the people, I don't think anywhere in the world exists, right? If you take vocational training, now there are 18 institutions, state alone, right? Catering for all vocational industries. But the issue is the modernization, right? So I think all other stakeholders within the government, private sector, of course, you modernize naturally, otherwise you extinct. True. So it naturally happens. So the government organizations, as well as, you know, education related stakeholders must understand and innovate and think on how to improve ourselves. You can't attract people for a, you know, substandard or, you know, expired product, right? It has to be 100% up to date with the world. So in my SC experiences, we have already started doing that. And from next year's intake, I think I'm proud to say we will be the most advanced and modernized vocational institute in the country.
Right. That is a very important thing to really note, because there lies a huge portion of people that can be employed, the youth specifically. Something I want to shift from this point onwards is, now you did touch on sports, and I want to touch on that as well. We saw that a very sustainable positive sign within the Olympics even this time was that a lot of people, we were capable of having them entered within the competition. Sri Lanka made a name there, and that is what's important, that we keep going, that we keep trying. And that is one part of it, and the Olympics is the only thing that is important. How has that industry or that side, because youth are the most interested within sports, within this entire entire industry also, how has that, you know, part, has this been forgotten, or has the NYSC, you know, really, you know, having some thought process there as well?
No, not really. Now, NYSC, as I told you, has all of these, you know, from Yauvana Krida to volleyball to several, you know, national level programs, but they are not modernized. They are not attractive. Nobody knows.
Sure.
And you are spending millions of rupees, right? Close to half a billion, I would say. So in that sense, we are going to modernize, because this year we were planning to start the youth sports events in August, but unfortunately now the Delta variant is playing havoc. So those are all physical activities which you cannot do online. So likewise, now volleyball especially, with the approval of the Honorable Minister, I'm going to take over the development squad of Sri Lanka, where it's a sport where we have a realistic chance of going up first in the Asian region, maybe if we do it properly, even at a global stage. So likewise, I think the enthusiasm, or the how do I put that?
The the interest that has been created.
The interest, not only that, the
participation aspect of
rejuvenation,
right,
of the sporting industry, naturally came because of Nama Rajapaksha. Nobody else. I mean, I'm not talking about politics. Him being a sportsman and the interest he shows and the commitment he has, you have to have you know, visible results. Now I know how hard he worked on getting Matilda Carlsen to, you know, get into the equestrian event, which nobody, right? I have seen that on television, but I didn't know what to call that also, right? Nobody of Sri Lanka knew about, right? That's how you take your brand to a global stage. So I think with the current programs, we are very much actively helping the sports ministry as NYSC. We will have very visible and productive results, not only in the Olympics, not only in cricket, where it's the most popular sport, even in national sport like volleyball, we will see very visible results.
Visible results. Yeah. All right, positive sign there. Let's go into our last segment and give a conclusive message to the youth of this country. Stay with us on Gen XYZ. Gen XYZ, we are in our last segment. We are in conversation with Damitha Vikramasinghe, the chairperson of the National Youth Services Council. In moving to a conclusive note for the entire program, I want you to address the youth directly and really talk about, you know, let's do this sort of thing together, and, you know, we can go forward, push forward in where this country is going to go. one issue that we always face in multiple scenarios. Now, I've had the chance to speak to a lot of people across within this platform as well. In separate sectors, we don't know the exact situation on the ground. We have to go on hypotheticals. We have to talk about data systems that don't really include a huge model. And recently, I came across the fact that the NYC and you were part of this created this survey. Was this successful in serving the youth? How exactly can we reach to it? Because if we had that picture, even the youth, even employees, even any sector within society can have a look, okay, this is where we need people, this is where the issues lie, that sort of understanding. So tell us a bit about this survey.
To tell you frankly, a survey like this has never happened in Sri Lanka. So that itself is a winner. So. And also, we have launched it about a couple of days ago. The main purpose is, Danidu, as you correctly said, nobody knows what's happening, right? There are standalone departments with standalone statistics, but when you want to get a cumulative picture, there is no way that you can, put all these data points together. So, having that in mind, the Honorable Minister gave us instructions on how to expedite and get the current picture assessed. So with a team of able private sector higher management also, who were voluntarily coming in to help, we managed to create this digital survey where you have the survey. The beauty of the survey is we have given you answers also, right? You have identified the potential problems and the workable solutions, right? You can, if you just throw out a survey, there could be, answers or
multiple interpretations,
multiple interpretations of some things that even, the most advanced country in the world will not be able to do. So we have given them the answers of what is possible, what is realistic, what we can achieve in a 5-year cycle. So that is rolling out very popularly. This is not restricted to youth clubs or any, membership that is attached with the youth ministry or NYSC. This is aimed at all 4.9 million population within the youth segment that exists in Sri Lanka, because for the simple fact, if you want to take decisions for the future, you have to have a proper idea of what the current situation on ground is. Like you correctly said, Sri Lanka, we are taking decisions on samples, right? We just, take a cross section, right? And which is very weak in a way. So I think Minister Namal Rajapaksha, being the state minister for digitalization, is also, conducting several programs which is addressing that issue, especially the digitalization of the identification card. As well, it's going to be a single card in the future. I think that will be another discussion altogether.
Yeah.
So I think this survey will be very valuable, and I think it's a duty of the youth of the country to participate in that, because it won't take you 5 minutes, but you're giving out the real picture to help us to take decisions for you. True. We are not taking decisions for ourselves, it's for you.
True. Very important sort of creation there, I should say, like even for us when we assess information, it becomes something important. Towards the conclusive part of the program, I want to talk about empowerment in particular. Now, we did talk about challenges, and I think your style of speaking has always been to prioritize solutions over problems. Today, if we do address the youth, what do you expect for the, what does the state expect, or what does the NYSC in general expect the youth to really think about as of today? What should we be doing? How can that empowerment happen? Because we don't really want to bring up this conversation every time a few months before an election and be like, okay, get the youth empowered and get them into election, get them into, positions of power. How can that, that process, as you mentioned, how can a youth be taken to a level where decision making is possible, having a fruitful life on the other side, also having, make their own, make money, make their own businesses, make a name for themselves. What should that thought process be as of now?
No, first of all, now we have to build the digital citizen that the world expects. There is no other way. If not, we will be left behind and we will probably be like, you know, unfortunately, like something like Afghanistan, which is very unfortunate and which is very heartbreaking to see. So in creating that, also the youth of the country have a responsibility. You must always, you know, individualistic interest has to be there. Otherwise, this free market system or the open economy will not work. But you must also think collectively. How can we come up collectively, right? The entrepreneurship scheme that I talked to you about, there are several stakeholders involved in one single ecosystem. There is the cattle milk producer. There is another entrepreneur who grows grass. There is a cooperative which collects the milk, right? So likewise, we must think and we must, you know, think as Sri Lankans, have that value and have a commitment to drag everybody up along with the journey that you take to go up in life. And we have, as government institutions and the government authorities, we have created many programs. But for all of that to be success, your participation is very much essential. Otherwise, you know, I always say wherever I go, the minister or myself, we cannot, you know, become entrepreneurs and we have no interest. We have interest of seeing people, especially the youth, becoming entrepreneurs within the tenor that we serve the country. So I think the responsibility and the commitment should come from the youth itself.
Right. We have a few more minutes. I want to get your final take on this. As the chairperson of the NYSC, I'm pretty sure you will be faced with a lot of questions from the youth, from parents, from multiple stakeholders. Is there an answer that you have had to give consistently all throughout these encounters to these people pertaining to, okay, we started this discussion mentioning now the question shouldn't be what the state can do for the youth, but what the youth can do for the state. What exactly are those answers that you have had to give? How could you have crafted them, or how can the youth as of today craft their lives better? Now, you did mention that we should subscribe to this digital citizen and, you know, have that digital knowledge, you know, background going on. What else? What are the other answers you give to these people?
Yeah, I mean, the top two answers would be, you know, convincing them about becoming an entrepreneur, which, you know, the hysteria is immense. I mean, it's unbelievable when you especially meet parents and, you know, the first sort of stakeholders, a young personality's life is involved. The resistance is unbelievable. You have to keep on telling them how, you know, how countries like USA, Japan, even the economic miracle of the modern world, the People's Republic of China, the base is entrepreneurship, nothing else. Nobody, no country has come up in terms of economy or technology or whatever sense without having a solid entrepreneurship base. So for that, I think that is one of the hardest answers that I keep on, you know,
to emphasize.
Exactly, emphasizing and disclosing over and over again. And also the importance of digitalization, that also you have to repeat, keep on repeating to the previous generation. I mean, youth of the country, they are digital savvy enough. I mean, internet usage stands at 40%, which is very high for a middle income country. So I think those two questions would be, you know, the you know, sort of golden rules of being the messiah of NYSC.
As a very last point, is there hope? Do you think there is hope for the youth? Do you think the youth, when you leave your tenure within the next few years, we will see something different given the immense amount of challenges that the youth and the country are going through, COVID and, you know, so many other things? Where do you look at to see that there is hope, there's room that we will have development, we'll have a youth that is capable moving towards a very competitive future?
No, there is always hope. No, if not the human you know, race will be extinct. The human race has faced several challenges. Now, exactly 100 years ago, we were hit by Spanish flu, but our grandparents survived. That's why you and I are here, right? So likewise, I think positivity is the way to go.
Mm-hmm.
You must always, you know, think about yourself as well as think about the rest of your immediate stakeholders. Don't think about the country. Think about how many people you can practically, you know, be a positive energy towards. And then naturally the country will grow up, definitely. And also whatever, you know, the brilliant, I would say, programs, especially in the entrepreneurship this government has managed to put together. If the people of the country reap and have the enthusiasm to go forward and reap the maximum benefits, I think there is more than hope.
Mm-hmm.
We can
tangible results.
Tangible results. Also, we can very positively look into the future.
All right. Very good note to end our discussion. The chairperson of the National Youth Services Council and the Director General for Youth Services within Sri Lanka, Damith Wickremasinghe. Thank you so much for giving us this time during this time period, coming over to our studios and really discussing this very pertinent matter now that we just passed World Youth Day on August 12th. Thank you once again for joining us.
Thank you.
I thank our viewers for staying with us on GenXYZ. Stay with us on, join us again next week as we bring to you another pertinent topic that is contemporary to the youth. I'm Danijithan Vasalam. Have a great night.